After 7 years of slowly increasing, the Seattle minimum wage has finally reached $15 per hour. Now, that issue was a main focus of our next guest campaign for Seattle City Council. Here to explain how she helped to make it happen and discuss the potential for a national minimum wage raise is Kashama Sawant. She is a City Council member in Seattle. Great to see you again.
Thank you for having me.
Of course. I just would like you to take a moment to reflect on when you were fighting for a $15 minimum wage in Seattle. This was seen as like a crazy outlier, fringe idea, and yet here we are now, 7 years later, with it going fully into effect across the city. What has it been like to see that shift in the national conversation? What has the impact been like locally?
I think the whole impact of since we made Seattle the first city to major city to win the $15 minimum wage and seeing it go nationally with victories being won in many cities and states, and now the question of federal $15 minimum wage is truly exciting. And it's a tremendous confirmation of how contagious working class struggles and victories can be. When we win victories in one city or in one place in the world, we can win victories we can spur similar victories in other places, because what spreads is the idea of confidence, the understanding that we can actually win, but the way we win is by getting organized and fighting back.
That is such a great point. And I mean, we just saw in this past election, a $15 minimum wage increase passed in the state of Florida, which is now at this point, I mean, you call it a swing state or a red state, but certainly within the mainstream of American opinion, over 60 some percent of Americans support $15 minimum wage increase. You know, the center right president, Joe Biden, supports at least in theory, $15 minimum wage increase. What would you say to Democrats right now who are contemplating pushing this at the federal level and are facing some backlash from conservatives, of course, but also from their own ranks, people like Joe Manchin, who aren't sure that they're ready to go along with $15?
I think what we're going to see, of course, is the Biden administration will probably take some measures in the face of this massive crisis in order to defend their own capital system. The Democratic establishment is very pro-capitalist. But even so, we are already seeing him backtrack on many things. We saw how the $2,000 stimulus check became maybe definitely $1,400, then maybe $1,400. And now they're saying that they're going to be negotiating with Republicans. And as you said, even within the ranks of the Democratic Party, they're going to face this opposition because many of them are openly pro-big business. And we're going to see even more obstacles in the question of $15 an hour federally, because there will be fierce opposition, as you said, from Republicans, many Democrats, and from big business themselves. So the real account of how 15 was won in Seattle is going to be educational to activists and young people watching your show. In Seattle, 15 did not win because of the Democratic establishment which controls the city. When we started, there was one vote on the city council for $15 an hour. That was me. We won with the labor movement, with united struggle involving labor activists and community groups and socialists. But at the end of the day, it was the socialist strategy that was the winning strategy, not even the strategy of some of the key labor leaders, because a lot of the labor leadership right now is very tied to the Democratic establishment. And at that time, they didn't want the socialists to campaign on 15. They preferred a wage theft campaign instead because they didn't think we could win 15. And then they did admit that that was mistaken, and they wanted to fight with us. And so we ran a massive grassroots campaign for city council, you know, when I was first elected to city council, with $15 an hour front and center as a campaign demand. And that's how we really first put 15 on the map of Seattle, because we forced the establishment to take notice of that. And then a few weeks after I was elected, my office, alongside some left labor unions and community organizations, we launched the 15 Now grassroots movement. We organized mass or action conferences, rallies, marches. We took to the streets. And most importantly, 15 Now used the tactic of a ballot initiative threat, meaning a credible threat that we will go directly to the voters if the city council Democratic establishment did not act right away and pass $15 an hour. And in fact, big business openly acknowledged later that it was the 15 Now ballot initiative that finally forced them to concede. And that was the real threat that they faced.
It's so important to hear those details of how you actually were able to use political leverage to force the change ultimately to happen. Did you see a backlash once this was ultimately implemented? And I just have to remind people, like, it feels very mainstream now. This was painted as some crazy, utopian, disastrous idea at the time. So respond also to, you know, what was the backlash, and have you seen the catastrophic consequences that the naysayers predicted?
We as we had said when we were fighting for $15 an hour, that what would spread if we passed 15 in Seattle is the $15 an hour minimum wage itself. And that's exactly what happened. When 15 now won the victory in Seattle, what happened was businesses were not impacted in a negative way. What spread instead, you know, they the Chamber of Commerce, the restaurant industry, the retail industry, so many big businesses were threatening and even, you know, issuing dire warnings that if you pass $15 an hour, that is going to be nothing short of economic apocalypse in the city, that businesses were going to be run out of the city, and the economy was going to plummet. None of that happened. And of course, we had predicted that none of that was going to happen. And as an economist myself, I knew that none of that was going to happen. But the point is that this is ultimately about a political struggle, and it's about changing the balance of forces from away from big business and the ruling class towards ordinary people. And by changing that balance of forces, we were able to win and prove, you know, to in retrospect, that none of that happened. And what did actually spread around the nation was not economic devastation because of 15, but the 15 Now movement itself won victories in city after city, including Minneapolis, Los Angeles, and as you said, Florida, a state that went for Trump. Those voters themselves voted for $15 an hour. And I know ultimately when big business says, oh, it's going to be bad for the economy, what they mean is it's going to be bad for the bottom line of the richest people in our society. And what they fear the most is the example of successful movements. They don't want that to spread. And in fact, just to give you another example, last summer, our Tax Amazon movement won the Amazon tax to tax big businesses to fund social housing and Green New Deal programs. Right now, we are under threat. You know, the Democrats themselves are threatening at the state level to repeal it or to limit it in some way or phase it out. Lawsuits after lawsuits are going to be filed by the Chamber of Commerce. We had similar lawsuits against $15 an hour filed by the Chamber of Commerce. None of them succeeded, but this is the kind of wearing down process that the capitalist class, that the billionaires use to discourage movement from building and fighting and winning.
And then finally, what's your response to Joe Manchin, who would say, sure, $15 in Seattle is an expensive city, maybe that works for them, but it won't work here in West Virginia. What would your response to him be?
Well, I would ask him to talk to actual workers, rank and file, on the ground, ask them how it's working out for them with the current minimum wage, and do they think $15 an hour is outlandish or crazy? And ultimately, my message would be to the workers and ordinary people and union members in West Virginia. I mean, look at the tremendous historic victory that the teachers won in West Virginia just a few years ago. They won that by using a rank and file grassroots strategy. In fact, the rank and file leaders rejected the compromise negotiation that the top union leaders made with the politicians in West Virginia. And that's how they kept on their strike, and that's how they won. And I think that is the most encouraging message of all. And that is how we are going to win 15 federally. And absolutely, workers in West Virginia, workers all across America deserve not only 15, they deserve Medicare for all, a genuine Green New Deal program to address the climate catastrophe. We deserve a different kind of society altogether.
So well said, and such an important point, that the way that you won in Seattle when this was seen as completely impossible wasn't by appealing to the politicians, but by forcing pressure from the grassroots up. It's so great to have you, Councilwoman. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for having me.
Coming up, Maxine Waters and Janet Yellen are calling on Redditors to testify before Congress over GameStop. We're going to talk about that when Rising returns.